Hello and welcome to another Magic Duels gameplay. Today we're taking a look at a Naya colored tokens deck that tries to make lots and lots of small creatures and then reap the rewards by playing cards like Veteran Warleader, which his power and toughness are equal to the number of creatures you control, and you also get some other ally synergies which we have. Some other payoff cards for playing lots of tokens: Valor in Akros, a 4 mana enchantment that whenever a creature enters a battlefield under your control, creatures you control get +1/+1 until end of turn, so it gets a lot better when you can make multiple creatures with just one card, because then you get +1/+1 multiple times. And another sweet card is Retreat to Emeria, which can either make tokens or give all our creatures +1/+1 until end of turn. And then of course we all know Gideon, which can also make an emblem to give all our creatures +1/+1 permanently. So let's take a look at all the tokens we have in the deck. Starting off with a small elf package, we've got 3 copies of Sunblade Elf. For just 1 mana we get a 1-1, but usually we'll become a 2-2 if we control a plains, and then later in the game for 4 and a white we can give all our creatures +1/+1 until end of turn, which of course is another reward for playing a bunch of tokens. Then we also have Dwynen's Elite, which is a 2-mana 2-2 that makes an elf token if we control another elf, so works very well with turn 1 Sunblade Elf and with the other elves we control. Like for example Elvish Visionary, 2-mana for a 1-1 that draws us a card when she enters a battlefield, so just keeps the cards flowing while still putting a body into play, which is irrelevant for cards like Dwynen's Elite, and just to have an additional creature that can start attacking. Then for removal we have 1 copy of Reprisal to deal with large things. Then 2 copies of Twinbolt, which is actually a pretty important card in the tokens decks, because if you're making a bunch of tokens and the opponent is making a bunch of tokens, you want to have answers that can efficiently deal with all those enemy tokens, and Twinbolt does exactly that, can clear up to 2 1-1 tokens, and can also go upstairs if you're playing against a control deck. We've got 4 copies of Dragon Fodder, just very efficient, 2 1-1 tokens for 2 mana. Then we've got Firemantle Mage, which is an interesting inclusion. He's got the Rally ability, so whenever he enters a battlefield or an other ally enters a battlefield when the mage is in play, our creatures gain menace until end of turn, so this makes it a lot more difficult for the opponent to block and possibly eat our creatures for free. So we can keep attacking and keep applying pressure, and we do have a decent amount of allies in the deck, or cards that make ally tokens, to enable the rally so we can get the effect multiple times. Then we've got a small Thopter package here, 3 copies of Thopter Engineer. 1-3 gives all our artifacts haste and makes a 1-1 Thopter token with flying, that's also an artifact. So we get 2 creatures for 1 card, and also synergizes with our other Thopter generators, like our Ghirapur Gearcrafter, which is a 2-1 that makes a 1-1 Thopter token. We already covered Veteran Warleader, but I will also want to mention the ability here. If you tap another untapped ally you control, you can give the Warleader all sorts of abilities like First Strike, Vigilance or Trample, so it can be very useful. Then we also have some more Thopters here in Pia and Kiran, by far the best token generator in the deck, since for 4 mana we get a 2-2 and 2 Thopter tokens, so a total of 3 creatures that hit the battlefield, so very powerful with Valor and Akros in play, and then we can also sacrifice artifacts to deal 2 damage to a creature or player. Then we discussed Valor and Akros and the enchantment Retreat to Emeria, which we do have the Evolving Wilds to synergize with the landfall ability. And then we also have 1 copy of Unified Front, which in this deck can make up to 3 1-1 core ally creature tokens for 4 mana, so can trigger the rally abilities, can be used to give the Warleader all sorts of abilities, and can also give our creatures +3/+3 until end of turn if we have a Valor and Akros in play, for example. And then 1 copy of Gideon, because he's amazing in this deck, making ally tokens or giving creatures +1/+1, or of course just turning into a creature himself. Our mana base is not great since we are a 3-color deck and we don't want to play too many lands that come into play tapped. So white is mainly a splash color. We're kind of cheating on the requirements for Gideon, so we don't expect to play Gideon on turn 4 every time. But we only have two planes to go with the Sunblade Elf as well as some other cards that count as planes. We've got 6 mountains because red is our main color, but we also need some green for the early elf cards, so 3 forests. Then 2 copies of Cinder Glade, 2 copies of Canopy Vista, which is also planes for the Sunblade Elf. And these lands also work very well with the following 6 lands, which are Rootbound Crag, Clifftop Retreat, and Sunpetal Grove, since these 6 lands will come into play untapped if we have one of these in play, which is great. And then the 4 Evolving Wilds for mana fixing and also for landfall purposes. So that's the deck. Now let's jump into some games and see how the deck does. Alright, let's take a look at our opener. No red mana, so let's try another one. Alright, this one can work. So let's see, what land do we lead with? I think we lead with the Vista, so we have white in play, and then next turn we can play a Visionary. And this also comes into play untapped, so we can also play Dragon Fodder if we want to. So Evolving Wilds from our opponents could be anything, I guess, except for mono red. Another Dragon Fodder. Interesting, so we could play the Visionary, hope to draw into a 3-drop, so that our next turn can be a little more mana efficient. Otherwise we can just play Dragon Fodder, next turn play Cinder Glade Dragon Fodder, and then turn 4 play 2 Visionaries, which also seems fine, and applies more pressure than just playing a Visionary here. So we get 2 Goblin Tokens, and of course, hoping our opponent doesn't have any sweepers, because that's a good way to beat tokens. So blue mana, so far so good. Blue red. So our opponent could have a Twin Bolt here to kill both tokens. But interesting, so we drew a Thopter Engineer. So if we play the forest, we can play the Engineer and attack for 3 essentially. But that means next turn we probably won't have access to 4 mana. But I think it's worth it. So let's try it. Play Engineer if our opponent has Twin Bolt, they kill the Thopter and a Goblin Token. So we still get in for 1. And we make our future Thopter generators better. Instead it's just going to be a Fiery Impulse killing the Thopter token. Fiery Impulse, not a great card against us because most of our cards make multiple tokens. So blue-red. Is your opponent playing the Thopter deck? They are. Their own Thopter Engineer here. This can be a tricky matchup because our opponent plays Chief of the Foundry, which gives all their artifacts +1/+1, and we don't have any efficient removal to deal with that. So it kind of comes down to who draws more Anthem effects. If we can draw some of our enchantments, we can be favored. And here Firemantle Mage is interesting. Certainly the more mana efficient play, and means our opponent can't eat any of our Goblin Tokens. And then we can play the Cinder Glade, next turn play a bunch of 2-drops. Seems decent. And any future allies we draw give our creatures menace again. Opponent takes 3 damage, goes down to 15. There's a Pilgrim's Eye. Maybe fixing our opponent's mana, getting a second blue source for Whirler Rogue next turn. Oh, forest, interesting. So our opponent is a 3 or more color deck. but probably don't have any play for single green. Could have a Might of the Masters, I guess, but that's not a commonly played card. So we take two, thanks to the haste from the Thopter Engineer. Twin Bolt is pretty nice here. So we can attack with everyone. If our opponent blocks the Mage, we can kill the Engineer plus one of these two. If our opponent blocks a Goblin token, that would be the worst case scenario. Do we want to play Visionary pre-combat? I don't think we do. So let's attack with everyone and hope our opponent does not block a Goblin token. Alright, our opponent just took all the damage. So we can play Visionary plus Twin Bolt to two tokens. Or we can play Dragon Fodder. I kind of like playing the Visionary. Try to dig into our more powerful cards and keep up white mana. Alright, Dwynen's Elite is not bad since that'll make an Elf token. Or we can use Twin Bolt here. So Twin Bolting is good here if our opponent plays a Chief of the Foundry next turn, for example. Then we can take care of these creatures before they get +1/+1. So I kind of like doing that, because we still have another Elf should this one die for the Elite in hand. The only question is, do we Twin Bolt right now or do we wait? I don't mind Twin Bolting now. Also plays around possible counter spells. So let's pass, see if our opponent has any big creatures here. So there's the double blue. Do they have a Whirler Rogue? Nope, just another Pilgrim's Eye. Which is going to get another island and a Perilous Mirror with haste. Perilous Mirror also decent against us. But no attacks, our opponent now staying on defense. So let's see, I think we start by playing our Visionary. Don't tap our white mana. See what we draw into. And we draw into an Evolving Wilds, which we can play here. So let's see, what happens if we attack with everyone? Our opponent can eat a Goblin token, eat another one, perhaps block here, and then deal 2 damage to here with the Firemantle Mage. Alright, let's just go for it, see what happens. So our opponent just blocking the Elvish Visionary. And then killing the Firemantle Mage. Alright, that's fine. Play Dwynen's Elite. And I think we play Evolving Wilds and get a Plains for, in case we draw a Gideon. So our opponent down to 5. They kind of need a sweeper here if they have one, but if they have one in hand, they probably block with more creatures last turn. So now they play the Whirler Rogue, which we were kind of expecting. Let's get our Plains and hope to draw Gideon, I guess. We do have a decent amount of powerful draws still. Valor and Akros is great with this Dragon Fodder in hand. Alright, interesting attack. Ah, so our opponent did have Might of the Masses. So it gets +5/+5. Hits us for 6, we go down to 11. We could play Might of the Masters ourselves, but I prefer running those enchantments that give us more lasting value. And we should play this pre-combat, of course, since we do have the Thopter Engineer in play, which will give our Thopter tokens haste. So let's attack with everyone. And see what happens. I don't think our opponent is dead right now, but if we get to untap, we can definitely try and kill our opponent with Pia Kiran if we have any artifacts left, but alright, looks like our opponent left, and there we go. So let's move on to the next one. Alright, let's take a look at our opener, which is a little bit slow with two lands that will come into play tapped. But we are on the draw, so hopefully we draw into a land that doesn't come into play tapped. Yeah, sure. So Evolving Wilds getting a mountain most likely. Let's see what we draw. Another Gearcrafter. Alright, so this is actually an interesting decision. If we play the Vista, then if we draw into a basic or one of the lands that checks for a basic type, then we can play the Visionary next turn. If we play the Evolving Wilds, then only if we draw a basic or one of the lands that corresponds to the basic we fetched will come into play untapped. So yeah, I think we kind of want to play the Vista, but then again, if we do draw one of our basics, then on turn 3 we will be able to play out our Gearcrafter, since this will come into play untapped. So it's actually an interesting decision. I think I'll go with the Evolving Wilds still. Get a mountain. And then hope to draw a basic plains or forest, or I guess even another mountain wouldn't be the end of the world, even though we wouldn't be able to cast a Visionary yet. Alright, so a pretty nice play here. Dauntless River Marshal turn 2 with an island in play. Alright, so no play on turn 2 for us, but we do have a couple Visionaries we can start playing, hopefully draw into some lands. We are playing a decent amount of lands in this deck, despite being somewhat aggressive deck. Mostly for mana fixing, for activating the Sunblade Elf, and to have some more lands for the retreats. Alright, so perfect curve so far. River Marshal into Sky Spawner. So really need to hit some land drops here. Alright, let's hope the Visionary brings us a land. Alright, there we go. So let's see, we have white, red, green. No double requirements in hand yet. So double white is for Gideon, double red is for Pia and Kiran. So I think I'll go with the red, since we have two Pia and Kirans and only one Gideon. So our opponent is going to attack just with those two. Alright, I would have blocked the sign if it attacked, but it did not. So we'll take 5 and get our mountain. And nothing else. Alright, so our opponent could be holding a counterspell for all we know. So this will come into play untapped, so we could play one of the 4 mana cards here, Unified Front or Valor in Akros, but I think we're a bit behind on board, so I would like to get a flyer in play so we can block the Sky Spawner. So it's probably between the Engineer and the Gearcrafter, and since we're gonna stay on defense and I'm suspecting a counterspell, I'm okay with playing out the Gearcrafter instead of the Thopter Engineer, which is a bit of a better card. But the Gearcrafter can actually trade with the River Marshal also. Alright, so no counterspell. Maybe our opponent has an adverse conditions here, which can tap down two of our creatures. Nope, alright. So if our opponent allows it, I'm definitely gonna trade, since we have a lot of powerful cards in hand. But our opponent could also tap down one of our creatures here, which would not be the end of the world, since that means our opponent is spending 4 mana and not adding anything to the board. So does our opponent attack? Yes, and with both. I can't think of too many combat tricks that blow us out here. I guess the one that gives 2 creatures +1/+2 until end of turn and gain some life could be bad for us. but so be it. If our opponent has it, they have it. Alright, so they just allowed this to happen. Interesting. And another Sky Spawner. Alright, so far so good. Another Valor in Akros. Definitely want to play some creatures before playing the Valor. So we could play the Visionary, hope to draw land so we can also play the Gearcrafter. Or we can just play the Engineer or the Gearcrafter here. I kind of like playing the Gearcrafter still. Although the Engineer does block the Sign Tokens better. So let's play the Engineer. And pause the turn. Still not really interested in attacking. Think we want to try and stabilize here. And then these Valor in Akros will be able to close out the game pretty quickly. Right. So definitely trading. And a Guardian of Tazim, which we do have a Reprisal for. Alright, so we can go Visionary plus Reprisal, or we can play Dragon Fodder plus Reprisal here. Would not mind drawing into some more land, so we can play multiple spells in the same turn, which makes the Visionary better. Playing the Dragon Fodder is better since that sets up our Valor. But then again, having the Fodder in hand is nice when you have a Valor in play, since that gives your creatures +2/+2 until end of turn. So I think I'm just gonna play the Visionary here. Hope to hit a land drop. Alright, there we go. And then Reprisal this. And we can even attack for 2 here. And this Evolving Wilds will, I think, get a white source. So let's do it now. And we can pass. Welcome turn is fine. So our opponent definitely on a blue-white tempo deck. So still could be holding up a counterspell, but... Alright, I think it's time to deploy a Valor in Akros here. Could also go for Gearcrafter plus Visionary, which also sounds appealing. Because if we draw into another land, next turn we could go Valor plus play Dragon Fodder, get an effect from the Valor right away, which is not bad. And this plays around the counterspell a bit better. So I don't hate it. Let's tap a red mana. Alright, there's a land, so we could still play actually the Valor in Akros here. Alright, let's start by attacking. And see what our opponent does. Just takes it. Alright, let's play a Valor and see if our opponent has a counterspell. They don't. Alright, so not sure what our opponent is holding. Maybe a bunch of expensive 5 drops. But there's not a ton in blue-white tempo. Maybe they do have adverse conditions but are just waiting to fire it off at the right time. Another welcome turn. And nothing else. Alright, interesting. Firemantle Mage. So can we kill our opponent this turn is a question. We can play a Gearcrafter. The token will have haste, so we definitely want to play this before the Dragon Fodder, since then the Thopter token we get from the Gearcrafter also gets the bonus from the Valor. Could also play Unified Front, make 4, or rather 3 tokens, plus a Dragon Fodder, so that gives our creatures +5/+5 until end of turn. Our opponent can only block one with one creature, since this one can't block. And then that is enough to kill our opponent. So I'm kind of worried about what our opponent could have here. They could have a Disperse to bounce the Valor also. So maybe playing another Valor and then playing a Dragon Fodder might be better. Because then even if they have a Disperse, we at least get a bit of value out of it. And I don't think we die next turn, so... Alright, let's go for this one. Play a Valor, play Dragon Fodder. Give our creatures +4/+4 until end of turn, unless our opponent disperses one of the Valors. Could also disperse a creature, I guess. Scatter to the winds, alright, that's fine. So they did have a counterspell, but elected not to use it on one of the Valors. Attack with everyone, since they're not gonna block anyways. We'll take 4 in the air, and then next turn any of these is gonna be enough to bump our creatures to win the game. So unless our opponent can keep some of our creatures tapped down or play a sweeper, I think we got there. Fifth land and nothing, so they could still be holding onto a counterspell. Pia and Kiran is nice, but I think we want to play 2-3 drops here. So I'm gonna bait a counterspell with the Firemantle Mage and then play the Gearcrafter. So if your opponent has a counter, they likely use it here. Nothing. So this is lethal right now. Play Gearcrafter, see if they have a response to this. They don't. Alright, and this should be more than enough. Go to combat. Attack with everyone. So our Thopter didn't get all the bonuses, but we were playing around a counterspell by playing the mage first. And looks like this was enough. Alright, sweet. Let's move on to the next one. Alright, let's take a look at our opener, which is a little bit land heavy, but we do have a pretty powerful card in hand in Pia and Kiran, plus a 2-drop. So I think we can keep. So turn 1, what land do we play? Interesting decision. We have Canopy Vista, which will come into play tapped, and then next turn we can play the Retreat or the Mountain, so that seems fine. Other option was just playing the Evolving Wilds to thin out our deck a bit, but usually want to keep this in case we draw one of our Retreats. Alright, let's run out a Dragon Fodder, turn 3 Gearcrafter, turn 4 Pia and Kiran. Looking pretty good here. We have double white, double red, so we can pretty much cast all our spells. Alright, so our opponent also in Naya colors. So we do have to keep sweepers in mind. But let's start by attacking, and then we'll play the Gearcrafter. Don't want to play the Warleader here, since still have very few creatures in play. So he's still vulnerable to potential burn spells. So let's play the Gearcrafter and hope our opponent doesn't have a Radiant Flames here. Twin Bolt would not be great for us, but still survivable. Alright, 3 mana, Radiant Flames, alright. We do get to follow up with Pia and Kiran though. So it's not all bad. And a Valor in Akros, interesting. So Pia and Kiran is nice as a follow-up to the Valor, but with no creatures in play. Maybe it's still better to just play Pia and Kiran into the Warleader. so get a bunch of Thopters. So still not sure what our opponent is up to. Could be a Naya ramp deck for all we know. Fiery Impulse is gonna kill Pia Kiran, which is fine. Still have two Thopters. And a Thopter Engineer now, but I think now is a decent time to run out the Valor and Akros. Since that will allow us to play the Engineer next turn, and then give our creatures +2/+2 until end of turn, and the Thopter we get from the Engineer will also be attacking. And I think it's fine to play out the Wilds in case we draw a land next turn, we can play both 3-drops. And let's just keep Acid Moss into consideration here. We have triple white, double red, so I'll get another red source here in case we draw our second Pia Kiran. And pass the turn. Nothing from our opponent. Alright, well, now I regret playing out Evolving Wilds, but so be it. Still going to play out the Engineer here, hope our opponent doesn't have Twin Bolt in response. Probably should have kept up green mana to represent pump spells. But there we go, Valor in Akros in action. Hit our opponent for 9. Next turn give our creatures +1/+1 until end of turn. And that should do it if our opponent doesn't play anything. Alright, there's an Acid Moss, which we don't really care about. Another Warleader, so let's play one. Trigger the Valor. And that's gonna do it. Hit for 8, our opponent's at 7. And there we go. Alright, let's move on to the next one. Alright, let's take a look at our opener, which I think is alright. We have Visionary into Elite, make a token into Pia Kiran, so I'll keep. Let's see what our opponent is up to. Lumbering Falls, so blue-green. Alright, Sunpetal Grove is not bad. Just gonna play out the Visionary. And draw into a Gearcrafter. Alright, so we have the option of either playing the Gearcrafter or the Elite next turn. I think we'll go for the Gearcrafter since that's more mana efficient. And I don't think the Visionary is likely to die against a blue-green. Does this change anything? We could go Elite plus Sunblade Elf, which puts 4 power into play instead of 3. So I guess that's a reason to go for that. Alright, sure. Let's hit for 1, and next turn play Pia Kiran. Or if our opponent is representing a counterspell, we could also play the Gearcrafter first. And if we get to 5 mana, we can start activating the Sunblade Elf. Alright, black mana into a Graveblade Marauder, which is pretty annoying here since we can't really attack into that. And now that also means if our opponent has a sweeper in black, we can lose all our tokens. But I don't think we can really play around a sweeper at this point. Can't cast a Gideon, unfortunately. Need another white source. So let's play Pia Kiran. And next turn we can activate Sunblade Elf, get in some damage. But for now we're staying back. The Graveblade Marauder is a pretty good blocker, as it turns out. So hopefully no Rising Miasma here. Instead, it's an acid moss, which is going to kill our only white source. So we're probably never gonna cast this Gideon this game, unfortunately. And we can also no longer activate the Sunblade Elf. At least acid moss is leaving soon. So let's see, we can play the Engineer, get a hasty Thopter. We could also attack with everyone. So we're trading a Pia and Kiran to get in for 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 damage, which might be worth it. On the other hand, activating Pia and Kiran also can deal some additional damage. We're definitely playing the Thopter Engineer here, so we can start by playing it. So we can either get in for 3 points, or get in for 8 and lose Pia and Kiran. I think I like getting in for 8. They could also perhaps block the Sunblade Elf, but no. So we lose Pia and Kiran, get in for 8. And next turn we can add another Gearcrafter. And then hopefully we can get there. Land into Sire of Stagnation. So we're definitely never gonna cast this Gideon. Untap, draw into another Gearcrafter, alright. So do we still attack with everyone? So 1, 2, 3, 4, put our opponent to 7. And then 3 more, put our opponent to 4. Alright, I think I like putting our opponent on a 2-turn clock here. Get in with everyone. Opponent does indeed block. And they take a whole bunch, go down to 4. We have 4 Thopter tokens in play plus some other random creatures. So hopefully that's enough to get the job done. But I guess we'll find out as we wait for our opponent to perhaps play a sweeper or gain some life. So it's a land, number 7, and alright, sweet. So despite never casting a Gideon, looks like we got there. So we could play the plains to activate the Sunblade Elf, but I don't want to risk our opponent drawing into a fog with the Sire of Stagnation. So I'm just going to attack with our Thopter tokens. See if our opponent has a fog or not. But I doubt it. And there we go. I want to thank you for watching. I hope you enjoyed this gameplay. And as always, have a nice day.